Spadowski. He's working with officials Lamont Simpson and Jeff Smith, and we are underway from Milwaukee.
Yeah, man-to-man defense by Milwaukee, and this is a very interesting contrast in styles. Valpo lockdown defense, top five in the country, and Milwaukee, 79 points per game. That's top 50.
In that Valpo starting lineup, Vasheel Fernandez is the fifth leading shot blocker in the country, and Peters starts off with a three. And that puts him over the 1,500-point mark for his career in the lineup for Milwaukee. Jordan Johnson is second in the country in assists. J.J. Podolski is the third leading shot blocker in the Horizon.
Rob Jeter told us yesterday their priority is post-oriented. The last thing they want to do is live with the three.
Rebound pulled down by Keith Carter, a transfer from St. Louis University. And here's a turnover. Milwaukee looking in transition. Comes to Tybee, lost the handle, but is fouled on the play. First foul of the night on Tavon Walker. So to the free throw line will go Tybee, and Tim, among the many things this young man does well is shoot free throws. He's an 83% shooter from the line.
He's a high-energy guy without question, and Rob Jeter told us, he said, I love him in a very special way. He's crazy in a positive way. I've never heard it quite put that way, but when you think about his versatility, strong in the post, makes his free throws, three-point range, and he is definitely the engine that gets this Milwaukee squad going.
Yeah, Rob told us he's an in-between guy, the way he described him. And he said he's always pretty good at hitting the three, but what separates him this year, he knocks down that 15 to 17 footer with consistency. This is Carter. Around the Peters screen, the runner by Walker is no good, and it's tipped up once, and the rebound pulled down by Tybee. Tybee's the second leading rebounder in the Horizon League. Johnson takes it right to the goal, lost his footing, and then Podolski with the miss, and here's Peters, and one of the Valpo players is down on the floor and injured, and will get a whistle to stop play as they take a look. It is Tavon Walker, 6'2 sophomore from Montreal. Just as the Milwaukee missed shot was being rebounded, he went down. Let's see if we can figure out what happened.
Yeah, on the blockout, looked like he took a hand across the face. And Bob, when I look at this matchup, they played already at Valparaiso, and the Crusaders won by 12. Kind of an aberration. Milwaukee had 0 points in transition, 0 offensive rebound points, and 0 points from their bench. I just believe in their building, they're going to be a lot better today.
Yeah, they got scored off the bench 23-0. Milwaukee highly motivated. They can improve their seeding for the Horizon League tournament, which will be at the Joe Louis Arena. Valparaiso has already clinched the league, so they'll be the number one seed. But one of the issues, I mean, you want to play every time you lace them up. But Valpo, if they do not win the conference tournament, can they possibly get an at-large berth in the NCAA tournament? Bryce Drew says, I think we're good enough. Joe Lenardi told us today that he thinks it would be a long shot. Many other things would have to happen around the country. But the more wins you get, obviously, it goes without saying, the better your at-large chances are.
At Motor City Madness at the Joe Louis Arena is all about winning 2 games in March. Don't worry about the at-large. Bryce Drew said, we're just going to take care of our own business, and we don't have to worry about Joe Lenardi or any bracketologist.
Low block, it went to Arians. Then on the kickout, Podolski knocks down the three. He's had a very good year from three-point range, shooting 40%. The way it works in the Horizon League, if you're a top two seed, you get a bye all the way to the semifinals, and you only have to win 2 games to win the conference tournament. The three ball is no good by Shane Hammack, and it will go back to Milwaukee.
The versatility of Milwaukee is tough to beat. All five starters average double figures, and the biggest challenge for Rob Jeter, he said, I think that Valpo's weakness is in the low post on defense. I don't want my big guys just settling for threes.
Akeem Springs with the miss, and the rebound is taken right out of the hands by Arians, and they'll get a reset on the shot clock. This is Arians with a deep three. still fought for and finally brought down by Vasheel Fernandez. In transition, Peters for three. Rebounded by Johnson. They don't need a shot clock so far, Tim.
Yeah, the matchup I'm really enjoying, Bob, is the point guard play. And that's part of the reason this pace is so quick. Jordan Johnson versus Keith Carter, a couple of guys are going to make sure that we see a lot of these quick shots throughout the game.
Johnson second in the country in assists. Carter third in the horizon in assists. Here's the shot clock all the way down to five. And the pass inside deflected out of bounds. 3 seconds to shoot. What are the Panthers' options here with so little time on the shot clock?
How about a down screen out of the swing offense? It's got to be a quick hitter on the baseline out of bounds.
Rob Jeter on Monday night picked up his 100th conference win in his career. Tatibe misses the three. It's an air ball and a shot clock violation. That 100th conference win for Jeter, he's only the third player coach in Horizon League history to get him. Meanwhile, that young man, Bryce Drew, has the third highest winning percentage in Horizon League history. The highest, a fellow by the name of Brad Stevens, who will be coaching the Boston Celtics tonight.
It's interesting you bring that up, because when I watch this Valpo team play, they remind me a great deal of Brad Stevens' Final Four team.
Stevens, of course, took Butler to back-to-back appearances in the NCAA championship game. Tybee down low, double team, doesn't matter. Rebound pulled down by Peters.
Maybe Peters is playing the role of Gordon Hayward for that team. Keith Carter, a little bit like Shelvin Mack. And I know that Bryce hopes they have the same kind of results in March.
Two teams have combined 2 for 12 from the floor. Carter misses the three. And on the rebound, it was last touched by Tybee. So it will be Valpo ball on the offensive end when we come back.
Jackson once said about Michael Jordan, when your best player is your hardest worker, coaching gets really easy. And I think that Bryce Drew is experiencing that.
Drew in his fifth year as coach. Peters misses the shot, falls down, and it will result in a run out. And counted and the foul. Akeem Springs with an N1 opportunity.
Rob Jeter learned his craft from Bo Ryan. He was an assistant coach at Platteville and UW-Milwaukee and Wisconsin. And when I watch Akeem Springs, he reminds me a lot of Orlando Tucker, who played for Bo Ryan. Big, strong, power guard, and actually left Madison as their all-time leading scorer.
Jeter played for Bo Ryan, coached under him at Platteville, here at Milwaukee, and also at the University of Wisconsin in Madison. We apologize. Inside, getting his first basket of the night is E. Victor Nickerson off the bench. Nickerson started in the last game because it was senior day for the Crusaders, so Bryce Drew went with an all-senior starting five. Tybee, his outlet pass, is stolen by Carter. One-on-one, misses the layup. Offensive rebound inside to Nickerson, but a traveling violation on the Crusaders. Third turnover for Valparaiso.
This has to be the kind of start that Rob Jeter was looking for. He said that there are a couple of game keys. He wants to be able to compete better on the glass and limit Valpo's second chance points. That was the big number in their first game. Milwaukee didn't get a single point off their offensive glass. The other key is slowing Hammock off the dribble.
They were outscored the paint, was Milwaukee in the first meeting, 40-16. Here's a foul on the perimeter on Jabril Adekoya. It's one on him, three on the team.
Will you say that number again, how they were out? That's a staggering number.
In the paint, outscored 40-16.
You're not going to win on the road with that happening.
We got a whistle, a clock issue. So Jeff Spadowski will walk over and try to straighten it out.
Now, this is the kind of basketball that I like to watch the best. Both of these teams make sense with their approach. Defensively, Valpo is the best defensive team in all of mid-major basketball. And Milwaukee utilizes their skills. They're very much perimeter-oriented. The big guys can handle. The guards can post up. And that kind of goes back to Bo Ryan's philosophy on offensive basketball. He loves to post his twos and his threes. Why? Because most guards and small forwards don't know anything at all about how to defend the post.
So they continue to try to work through this shot clock issue. This is the old Mecca where the Milwaukee Bucks played, and you played a few games here, Tim, in your eight-year NBA career, more than a few.
Yeah, you know, the highlight was that Dr. J, Julius Irving's last game ever, we lost in the first round of the playoffs to the Bucks, was right here. I don't think it's the same court, but it's the same building.
Tybee hits the perimeter shot. Panthers by four. Rob Jeter said, we'd love to get to 20 wins. They need two to do that, and we want to finish with a winning record in conference play. Right now, they're 9-7. First basket of the night by Shane Hammock. His dad, Geert, played in the NBA for Orlando and Golden State.
Yep, he was the backup center for Shaquille O'Neal at LSU.
A whistle before the shot.
And as we're talking about NBA influence, Bryce really learned a lot in his time in the NBA. Six seasons drafted by the Rockets, and he said that he learned spacing and taking advantage of mismatches from Rudy Tomjanovic and from Tim Floyd during his days in Chicago. He learned about misdirection and X's and O's.
Also played for the Hornets, first in Charlotte, and then when they moved to New Orleans. Inside, the layup is good by Cody Whitman. Missed the easy shot inside. Low block Peters. Passes out of the double team. His pass is stolen by Jordan Johnson. Off the two on one. And Arians is fouled. Foul will be on Nickerson. It's his second. Fifth team foul on the Crusaders. No team foul so far on the home team.
So Rob Jeter feels that his team is the best passing team in the Horizon. And he said, I don't think anybody could question that. They're number one in assists on the season. And they're so unique because most times big guys are not effective perimeter passers. But all of the big guys for Milwaukee are exceptional moving the ball one extra pass.
Getting a rest will be Tybee, the senior who spent a year at Kirkwood Community College. Arians, a junior from Stoughton, Wisconsin. His dad, Andy, played college basketball at St. Norbert's. Valpo, 3-for-11 from the floor. Heck of a screen. Was set there by Adekoya.
I don't believe that Valpo is worried. They've got this swagger about them, and it comes with 28 wins last year, which was a school record. They've got a lot of big game experience.
Off the inbound pass, Darian Walker buries the three. 33rd of the season for the senior from Chicago. So Valpo, despite their shooting woes and the disparity in fouls, finds themselves down only one, 8 minutes in.
All man-to-man so far for the Crusaders on defense.
Johnson penetrates, then on the kickout, the shot is no good, but going to the line will be J.R. Lyle. He was fouled, and he should be shooting three. The foul will be on Darian Walker. That's one on him and 16 fouls on Valparaiso. Absolutely, he'll be shooting three.
Yeah, I'm not sure there was a lot of contact there. Defensively, straight up and down, but JR sold it pretty darn well. This is the perfect bench spark type of player. He's the best athlete on the team, without question. An above the rim type of athlete. And very streaky from three, but Bob, isn't that what you want off your bench, is somebody that can change the game with their presence?
Valpo, Milwaukee relies less getting production from the bench than most teams because of the incredible scoring balance they have with the starting lineup. They're coming off a real tough stretch, Tim. And first of all, they played five straight on the road. This is their second straight home game. And they've won their last two. They went 1-4 on that road trip, but they've won their last two games, and they've won them by a combined margin of 66 points. So they're really taking it out on the visiting teams. Off the missed free throw, the rebound is pulled down by Tawan Walker. A year ago, Valparaiso went 13-3 in league play. They're sitting on 14-2 this year with a game left against Green Bay on Sunday. On the low block, the first foul of the night on Milwaukee. It only took 8 minutes and 2 seconds to get it. Timeout. Chance to win the conference tournament and go to the NCAA tournament for the third time in 5 years.
Vasheel Fernandez in the post helps out a lot, doesn't he?
Sure does. He's the fifth leading shot blocker in the country.
He's like the Mutombo of the horizon. I'm sure you're going to be talking about his shot blocking prowess in no time at all.
Off the miss. This is Johnson. Penetrates and kicks out to Panosky for his second three. He's got some range for someone 6'10", doesn't he? Milwaukee by 6. They've lost 3 straight and 8 of their last 9 in this series with Valpo. The miss by Adekoya, no good, gets his own rebound, then sets up Carter for a 3. And on the rebound, a pushing foul will be called on Milwaukee.
Now, what a unique player J.J. Panosky is. He's the all-time shot-blocking leader for the Panthers. You combine blocking shots with three-point shooting, you don't see that very often. Bryce Drew is saying that he's really enjoyed watching the development of the big guys for Milwaukee. Coming in as freshman, Panosky was not great. Tybee, same thing. They've developed and maximized their potential a great deal.
Less foul on Lyle, 1 on him, 2 in the team. Darren Walker with his second 3. So 6 points for Darian Walker, the senior who spent a year at Arizona Western Junior College, a year at John A. Logan College, and finishing up now with Milwaukee. Arians puts it on the deck, steps back. He'll be called for the discard. So he had 7 straight fouls on Valparaiso, and now 3 straight on Milwaukee.
You know, let's notice the defensive position. Everything was good. Left arm straightens, knocks him back, and that's a big blow right there. The nice thing for Valpo is they have tremendous depth. 9 Crusaders, Bob, they average over 15 minutes per game, so foul trouble should not be an issue.
Second foul on Arian, so he sits down. Darian Walker penetrates, then kicks out. Peters, in traffic, finishes with the left. He's got 5. The Milwaukee lead is down to 1. Panosky inside to Tybee. Had great position, missed the shot, follows with his own rebound, and then Fernandez comes away. Fernandez may have had a piece of that follow-up. Darian Walker with a wild shot just tried to draw a foul and succeeded in doing it. It will be on Tybee, his first, and 4 on the Panthers.
Yeah, there's so much emphasis defensively dealing with Alec Peters and Keith Carter. They create plenty of space for their teammates. And Darian Walker, hard-nosed guy, bench spark, about 6'3", 220, plays multiple positions.
We've got another Hardwood Super Saturday coming your way. 2 big-time matchups. First, in the ACC, Bryce Johnson in 7th-ranked North Carolina will take on number 3 Virginia. Then in the NBA at 8:30 on ABC, Steph Curry will take on Kevin Durant and the Oklahoma City Thunder.
Yeah. Really impressed with Steph Curry, obviously. First player in NBA history with 10 twos and 10 threes in a game.
Scored 51 points last night against Orlando. Broke the NBA record for most consecutive games with at least one three-pointer with 128. It's hard to imagine him ever playing a game without making a three-pointer.
And I love the Big O, but I have to disagree with what he said yesterday about how current NBA coaches don't know defense. As a matter of fact, I think that right now in the NBA, best defense it's ever been played. Players are more athletic, and they're more skilled shooting the ball. Sorry, Big O. Can't agree.
Of course, the three-point rule was not around during Oscar Robertson's playing careers. Tybee down low. He'll be called for the discard, and that's his... No, they're going to call it on Valparaiso. I'm sorry. It'll be on Darian Walker, his two, second. Not on the team. Oscar Robertson averaged almost 30 points a game in his NBA career. Imagine how many he would have averaged if the three-point rule existed back then.
Yeah, and if he could play without the hand check, I think that would be a big deal, too. But look, Steph Curry shoots the ball amazingly well. And look at this Milwaukee team as another example. Their 6'10 guys are knocking down threes with regularity. Guys today, young ball players, shoot more shots with shooting machines and shooting coaches, and it's just a whole different percentage of shooting that we've seen than in the past.
Tybee at 6'8 has knocked down 37 threes himself this year. And he gives Milwaukee the lead again. 9:20 remaining first half. Valparaiso looking for win number 25. Right now, Joe Lunardi has them as a 12 seed in his bracketology entering the night. Peters results in a wide open three.
I'm going to give that last possession an A+. Did you see the ball movement? I think that from what I've seen of the Horizon this year, that Valpo is easily the most disciplined team. And I hope we can watch that again, because that pass by Alec Peters is what separates him from most other big men.
Shot clock inside 10. Tybee screaming for the ball down low. Instead, on the penetration, Akeem Springs with the finish. Tied again at the 8.5-minute mark. Darian Walker sets up Peters for the corner three. He's got 8. A 45% three-point shooter, Alec Peters.
Big key for Valpo so far with their quick start. 10-2 advantage in bench points.
They had a 23-0 advantage bench points in the first meeting. Inside Tybee, that's just too easy. Walker can't handle it that close to the hoop. 7 for Tybee. Valpo is 5-for-10 from three-point range and just 3-for-9 inside the arc tonight. Here's Peters going right at Tybee. Went off Carter's knee. Turnover number 5 for Valparaiso. Johnson takes it to the rim. And Bryce Drew wants a timeout. So back and forth, they exchange the lead, and it's Milwaukee by 1.
I don't think that Princeton has been there much since the days of Pete Carril. I wonder if they still do the backdoor cut under Mitch Henderson, who is a Princeton guy for sure.
Yale and Princeton each with one loss in the league, each beating the other on its home floor. If they wind up tied, it'll come down to a one-game playoff like it did last year, and Harvard beat Yale to go to the NCAA tournament a year ago.
How nice that Valpo threw the backdoor cut right at the perfect time for us.
Springs. Shot clock inside 5. On the drive, and Whitman is unable to finish. Here's Nickerson for Valpo. And a blocking foul will be called on Tybee. That'll be his 2nd and 5 on the team.
31-man Tybee, second personal.
Yeah, that's a big foul on Tybee. He's He's going to have to sit down. And what's wrong with that defense? Absolutely nothing. That's one that I let go. Principle of verticality. His body was straight up and down. Nickerson did draw contact. And valuable sub is Nickerson.
Well, tonight after our NBA doubleheader, keep it locked to ESPN for SportsCenter at Night with Stan and Neil live from L.A. They'll have all of the highlights from the NBA, NHL, college basketball. We'll have the news on today's big FIFA presidential election and the latest from spring training and the NFL Combine. It's SportsCenter at Night right after the Grizzlies and the Lakers tonight on ESPN. Valparaiso by two away from the ball. We're going to get a foul on Adekoya, his second. And that should be the 10th team foul on Valpo. So that will put Milwaukee in the double bonus and will be two free throws for the rest of the half.
Back in high school, J.J. Panoski was the tallest cross-country runner in the nation. At 6'10".
Probably a pretty good stride, huh?
Yeah, and one of the great training techniques that Milwaukee uses, they have a massive size hill right on Lake Michigan. And they have the battle for the hill each year where, as part of their preseason conditioning, the players have to run up and down 10 times. Eventually, they get to the point where they do it 20 times. I bet the JJ does pretty darn well for a 6'10 guy.
Hammock with the putback. That's not one of those deals where it's uphill both ways, is it?
There you go. Up and down is one.
And not to try to avoid landing in the lake.
You could do that when you're sledding in the winter.
Johnson with an incredible drive. He is fearless. He's got four. And the Valpo lead is one. Milwaukee's best player, Tybee, on the bench with two personal fouls. Shot clock inside 10 for Valpo. Nickerson with the step back. And on the rebound, we get a whistle and a little pushing and shoving. And which way is it going to go here? Foul is going to be on the Panthers, and it'll stay at this end.
Yeah, let's take a look. There's something extracurricular, good defense. I think they're going to have to take a look at that.
I think they called it both ways, Tim.
Yeah.
They called it on Carter for Valpo and on Jordan Johnson for Milwaukee.
Jordan Johnson plays like the under-recruited kid that he is. He won't back down. He's physical. He's tough. And really, you know, we've talked a lot about Tybee. Jordan Johnson might be their best player this year.
Well, he's second in the country in assists. He leads the Horizon League in assist-to-turnover ratio. He had a triple-double last time out on Monday night against Youngstown State.
Triple-tens.
10-10 and a 10.
Yeah, Bob, this is the first time we've seen zone in this game by Valparaiso.
Shot clock inside 10. Johnson around the Panoski screen, then kicks out to Panoski, looking for his third three of the night. Long rebound on a bounce to Adekoya. Low block Fernandez. We have yet to see him take a shot tonight. He's only averaging 6 points per game. Nickerson drives and lost the ball. He touched it last.
Cody Wickman with a stellar defensive stance. Everybody talks about how Valparaiso is one of the best defensive teams in the nation, but I really like the start defensively by the Panthers. The philosophy that Rob Jeter uses is build a fort around the lane. Dick Bennett started that when he was at Wisconsin. His son Tony Bennett at Virginia, same terminology. Pack line defense. Rob Jeter and Tony Bennett are best of friends.
Foul will be called on Hammink. That's number two on him. Again, Milwaukee in the double bonus, so everything will result in two shots. Rob Jeter spent a lot of time around Bo Ryan. He played for him at Wisconsin-Platteville, played on a Division III national championship team there, coached under Bo at Platteville, and they won two more championships when he was an assistant. Went with Bo and spent 2 years as an assistant right here at Milwaukee, and then 4 years at Wisconsin. And he told us the things that he learned most from Bo, the advice, keep things simple, stress situational preparation, and make sure your players know you care about them.
Nice. He had an Elite Eight and a Sweet 16 in Madison with Bo Ryan.
Wisconsin, of course, coming off back-to-back Final Four appearances, including a loss in the national championship game last year to Duke. Fernandez, kick out to Carter with a hand in his face. It didn't matter. That was a tough shot.
Rob Jeter's dad's pretty well known in the area as well, isn't he?
Yeah, his dad, Bob, was a great defensive back for the Packers and Bears. He played on the first two Super Bowl championship teams under Vince Lombardi at Green Bay. Down low, Johnson, or make it Springs with the miss.
Number one, 5'9 jet, Jordan Johnson, knocking down the three.
Bryce Johnson having a terrific season for Roy Williams. 3 minutes remaining in the half. Inside, Peters juggles, did a great job to keep the possession alive. Darian Walker misses the three, and the rebound pulled down by Panoski.
6 out of 12 from 3 for Valpo to start this game.
Away from the play, we'll get a hold in the post, and it will be called on Vasheel Fernandez. That will be his second.
I love Fernandez's story.
Yeah, it's an amazing one. He's from Jamaica, didn't start playing basketball until he was 17. He grew up in a house with 19 inhabitants. And he came to the United States, got a scholarship to play basketball at Milwaukee. He is a senior. He not only has graduated from Milwaukee, he already has his master's in international commerce and policy, and he's working on a second master's degree in international economics and finance. And his wife, Bridget, is expecting their second child in August.
Yeah, last year on senior day, he announced to the crowd that he wanted to marry Bridget. He got engaged in front of the crowd. He had a second opportunity to play this year. The NCAA granted him an extra year. And so on senior day last game, he told the crowd that they're expecting their second child. They already have Maya, and they're going to have another baby soon. That's using senior day to its advantage.
Bryce Drew, a big fan of the big fella. He called him a dominant figure on our campus. That's the seventh turnover for Valparaiso. Coming up, college basketball and NBA style tomorrow. First of all, we'll be in the ACC. We told you about that North Carolina-Virginia matchup. Then we'll switch to the NBA at 8:30 Eastern time on ABC. Steph Curry and the Warriors take on Kevin Durant and the Thunder. Curry leads the NBA in scoring. Durant is number three. Terrific NBA matchup tomorrow night on ABC. Down low, Panoski. That's his first shot inside the paint. Count it, and the foul.
Well, and I believe that that's Fernandez's second foul, and he's going to have to sit down. Rob Jeter said that Panoski is a huge key in this game. We need him in the post. He loves the perimeter, and they're going to force feed the ball. As a matter of fact, one of the biggest swing principles is to get the ball into the low post. They chart post touches, and Rob Jeter said that their goal is to get 15 to 20 touches in the low post, either by their guards or Panoski and Tybee. So far, nice job.
Tim, actually, that's the third foul on Fernandez, so that's an even bigger problem than we thought. So he will obviously sit out the remainder of the half, and we may not even see him at the beginning of the second half. You surprised that Bryce Drew kept him in the game with two fouls?
Yeah, I am, and I give a lot of credit to Rob Jeter for identifying and attacking with immediacy.
Milwaukee putting on a run here at the end of the half, opening up a six-point lead. 9-0 run for the Panthers, and the crowd is alive, and Peters tries to silence the crowd, can't hit the three, But we will have a rebound foul on Milwaukee.
Now, beautiful off the dribble. Nice athleticism by Johnson. 16-2 advantage. Points off of turnovers has been the difference in this one.
The foul on Wickman is first. That's number 7 on the Panthers. So that will put Valpo in the bonus. And Darian Walker will shoot the 1-1. Offensive rebound to Adekoya to extend the possession. Darian Walker drives and will get right back to the line. Number 2 on Jordan Johnson, 18 fouls on the Panthers.
Now, if I was going to target one area that I would be concerned about if I was playing against Valpo, it's their ability to put the ball on the floor. This is a drive without hesitation attack offense. And we know that Peters is their go-to guy, but you can't give too much attention to number 25 in yellow because there are many other weapons out there.
9th point off the bench for Darian Walker for Bryce Drew's team. Walker an 80% free throw shooter. Bryce Drew told us his team is a self-motivated group, never complacent. They want to go back to the NCAA. A year ago, they, in a first-round game, they lost to 4th seed Maryland. Heck of a game, a 3-point game.
Yeah, they had a 3 to tie it right down the stretch. The ball was stolen, but a valiant effort.
From the foul line, Springs can't get it to go inside the final minute. Peters for 3. And Johnson deflected the rebound to his teammate Brock Stull. See if Rob Jeter takes advantage of his first half use it or lose it timeout here. About a 4-second difference. Shot clock, game clock.
You know, late clock situations, always nice to get a high pick and roll for a creative ball handler.
Banowski set the screen for Johnson, who drives baseline pass deflected. 3 seconds to shoot now for the Panthers.
Yeah, last time in this situation, they utilized the ball screen to the elbow. And with 8 seconds to go, Bob, I think this would be a great time to call a timeout and target a hot score or a mismatch.
Especially since he can't carry that one timeout over the second half. But they will not use it. Instead, they get an entry pass into the paint and a foul on Nickerson. So you can't execute any better than that. 3 fouls on Nickerson. That's already 15 fouls in the first half on the Crusaders.
Yeah, beautiful execution. I think that Springs just simply went solo. He saw that the Valpo D was not concentrating. And this is a power guy right here. Akeem Springs, Northern Illinois transfer. Very well-rounded as a player. And in mid-January, had 33 points in a game against Youngstown State.
This will be the 20th free throw attempt in the first half for Milwaukee. So 7.5 seconds to go. And
Keith Carter is so fast. He's a guy that you want involved in this play somehow.
This is Tawan Walker with 5. Goes behind the back. Lost the handle. And a turnover. And that turnover right there was the first. Tybee, the leading scorer from Milwaukee this season, with 7 points in the first half. Keep in mind foul trouble. Vasheel Fernandez, shot blocker extraordinaire, has 3 personal fouls for Valparaiso as we begin the second half, and Fernandez is on the floor. Off the miss, the rebound is pulled down by Springs.
Now, Bob, there's 76 hours until the calendar hits March. And if Valparaiso wants to have a chance to be considered for an at-large if they don't win the tournament, right now they have to play with desperation for the next 19 and a half minutes.
A three by Springs, air ball, rebound pulled down by Tawan Walker. Valpo has already clinched the Horizon League regular season title for the fourth time in 5 years, and Peters buries the three.
Now, how in the world does he get that wide open? Everywhere he goes in the Horizon, the scouting report says the same thing. Find him early, don't leave him, and offer help when necessary.
Preseason first team All-Horizon League choice. He was the MVP of the Horizon League tournament a year ago. Arians trying to answer with a three, and the rebound is pulled down by Shane Hemmick, his third. The pull-up by Tawan Walker, rebound Jordan, and watch him. Off to the races. Plays right through contact, doesn't get the foul, and then Carter called for the travel on the rebound.
You know, I'll say it again. How does he get that open? That's about as sure a thing as you're going to find in this conference. And remember, when he was a freshman, he was only a shooter. And it's really been impressive and a nice compliment to the coaching staff for the Crusaders to see him become such a complete player.
Bonoski looking for his third three of the night. Rebound pulled down by Hammack again. Carter looking inside for Fernandez. They get it to him. And the rebound pulled down by Tybee.
Yeah, I have no problem with that possession. I think it's a great idea to throw Fernandez the ball every once in a while. When big guys get the ball in the low post, they defend and rebound so much better. Kind of like that.
Another turnover. That's only the fourth turnover for the Panthers. Fernandez had a season-high 14 points when these two teams met last month at Valparaiso. The Crusaders won it by 12. Hammack thought about it, and they feed the post again, this time with the right hand. And on the rebound, knocked out of Peter's hands, last touch by Milwaukee.
You get the sense that as Bryce Drew reviewed the first half, he felt like it would be a good idea to go inside. Maybe you can get that next foul on Tybee or Panoski. Uh-oh.
But they missed the throwdown. Offensive rebound Peters, and he'll get to the line. So Fernandez took one shot in the first 20 minutes. He's already taken three in the first 2:33 of the second. He'd like to have a do-over on that one, though.
Yeah, that's a beautiful delivery, and you know how I knew that Peters got fouled? I don't think he shoots the ball over the backboard very often.
It's the third foul on Jordan Johnson. Peters from the free throw line, 85%, third best in the Horizon.
Right now, Bryce is saying, look, next time we throw the dunk to you, make sure you put it in. And I'm really intrigued by Alec Peters and his NBA potential. At about 6'9". He's not quick enough to cover the small forwards of the league, and maybe not physical or tough enough down low to cover the fours, but I just have to believe that with his shooting ability, somebody is going to give him a long, hard look. Remember, he's only a junior and already has over 1,500 points.
Johnson's entry pass, but he turned it over. That's the fifth turnover for the Panthers. If Peters, he's averaging 17 per game. If he continues to average 17 per game, counting this game, it would take 37 games for him to break Valparaiso's career scoring record, which is held by his coach, Bryce Drew. And between now and the end of next season, barring injury, Valparaiso will play 37 games. Here's Hammond for three. Rebound on a bounce comes to Brock Stull.
Bob, I don't think we've talked enough about the great Homer Drew in this game.
Homer, of course, Coach Bryce, and his older brother was a head coach when his older brother Scott, who played at Butler, was an assistant at Valparaiso. He and his wife Janet are recovering from cancer. And a huge influence, obviously, on the lives of their two coaching sons. Bryce played for his dad and was also an assistant coach for 6 years for his dad at Valparaiso.
And his brother, Scott Drew, the current head coach at Baylor, who is doing an amazing job with the Bears. Bryce told us when he knocked down the shot in the NCAA tournament, the most memorable thing was knowing that his brother and his dad were there with him. And now that he has his own son, his name is Bryson, he really has a great perspective on the importance of his relationship with his dad and his brother.
Good penetration results in the open look for Darian Walker. And on the rebound, we get a pull down. I think Peters is going to get nailed for that one. No, it's the fourth foul on Fernandez. Wow. First team foul, second half. So Fernandez will have to sit down with 16 minutes remaining.
First time they played, Fernandez had 14 points. In this one, he's got four more fouls than he does points.
Fernandez, the leading shot blocker in Valparaiso history. Also a year ago set the single season record for block shots. And he's fifth in the country in block shots this year. But he'll have to sit down for quite a while now with his fourth. Low block Tybee. Here comes the double team. Passes out of it to Whitman, who shows why he is the most accurate three-point shooter in the Horizon League. On the drive, Nickerson, wild shot, rebound by Tybee. His fourth. Tybee thought about it. Instead, will set up Arians, no good, and here's Carter with the rebound. And a three from the corner for Darian Walker, his third three of the night. And we're tied again.
Valparaiso plays with great poise. And they have not lost a conference game this year except two against Wright State. And the way that Wright State did it was with methodical play. And I think that's what Milwaukee's doing.
Whitman, I think he looked for his footprints there, Tim. He found them and the shot found the bottom of the net again. Back and forth, they exchange threes. We haven't had a whistle in a while. Darian Walker, foot's on the line. It's a long two. It's an air ball, and that will bring us to our first timeout of the second half.
You know, with Fernandez out, obviously, Valpo's not as good on defense, but I think they're going to be more dangerous on the offensive end.
Brock Stull for three. Rebound pulled down by Darian Walker. Valpo 2-for-12 from the floor here in the second half. Peters puts it on the deck, and so does Walker. He has given them a huge lift off the bench with 15 points.
Bob, let's see if Milwaukee tries to get Cody Wickman, who is in a heat check zone, another three. He nailed two straight. Got to believe he's hot.
Johnson started to drive, had nowhere to go. That was terrific defense by Shane Hammack. Traveling violation on the junior from Waukegan, Illinois.
Yeah, I'm impressed with Hammack. His father, NBA player, and Hammack spent his first 2 years playing in the SEC for LSU. And when you watch him move out there, he's definitely an LSU caliber athlete.
The back cut didn't work too well, but sometimes you got to be in the right place at the right time, and Adekoya was. Valparaiso by one. For the fourth time in its history, Valpo won 21 of its first 25 games this year. Here's Johnson for three. Rebound pulled down by Peters.
The best part of the Valparaiso attack so far, 21-4, 21-3 advantage from beyond the arc.
Adekoya in the post, out to Hammack. To the cutter, Jawan Walker, but could not finish. Rebound Tybee is fifth.
Tybee has been quiet, foul trouble in the first half. Might be a good idea to try to jumpstart his game with something in the post.
He's only taken six shots. Shot clock at 10 for the Panthers. Johnson stops and pops. One-handed rebound for Darian Walker. His sixth. Low block, Peters spins. And the rebound is pulled down by Milwaukee.
Hey, why is it that Milwaukee has stopped attacking the rim as soon as Fernandez? What a special moment. I'm sure that's the highlight of the week for each of them.
Scott, an assistant coach on the Valpo team when his brother hit that shot. And they went on to the Sweet 16 where they eventually lost to Rhode Island. That's the deepest Valpo has gone in the NCAA tournament in nine trips.
And it would be foolish not to say hi to our friend Bryce and Scott, I'm sorry, to Scott right now, because I know that he's in his hotel watching right now in preparation for tomorrow.
Offensive foul is called on Tavon Walker. That's his second. As we went to that last break, Jordan Johnson picked up his fourth foul for Milwaukee. So he's on the bench with four. He's second in the country in assists. Vasheel Fernandez of Valparaiso on the bench with four fouls. He's fifth in the country in block shots. 1 point Valparaiso lead. The high screen set by Panoski. And the drive by Stull, no good. Rebound is pulled down by Peters, his fourth. Hammink leads for Peters. Another wide open three. He's got 16. This 4 point lead is Valpo's biggest lead of the night.
Peters does it quiet. He has not had a loud game, but 16 points with plenty of time to go. I like his patience and his poise, and he's passed up a few shots to try to get his teammates involved.
Shot clock down to six. Springs on the drive and hits over Darian Walker. He's got 10. Springs and Jordan Johnson were high school teammates at Waukegan High School in Illinois. Hammond puts it on the deck and finishes with the right. 8 points for him.
That's what Hammock does, right? He's a get-to-the-rim type of guy.
Panoski backing his way in on Adekoya. Rebound pulled down by Peters. Valparaiso has won 8 of its last 9. Adekoya for 3. Air ball. And here come the Panthers the other way.
Now 100% man-to-man so far by Valparaiso. They're the best in the conference. Top 6 in the nation in points allowed.
The spin move by Springs, but he could not get it done. Darian Walker lost control, but it was last touched by Milwaukee is the call. Are they going to reverse it? Two officials come together and they say, let's go back the other way.
A little sloppy both ways. Why? Because Jordan Johnson and Keith Carter have been out of the game. And if I gave you a whistle, would you agree with that call?
No, huh? No, I thought it clearly went off of.
Lucky you don't have a whistle.
Lucky for a lot of people, I don't have a whistle, Tim.
Once again, Tybee is being ignored. I don't think he's working very hard. He's a high-energy guy, and it's almost like his first half foul took his heart and soul away.
Low block Springs, the up and under move. Boy, he's worked hard. He's got a dozen. Back and forth they go. Valpo by 2. Adekoya.
Man, who do you focus on defensively when you play Valpo? They've got five guys out there that are all weapons. And Adekoya, he is a better offensive player than Fernandez. So Valpo has all of a sudden got much tougher to cover.
Foul on Darren Walker. That will be his third and the third team foul. Yeah, a year ago, Adekoya was the sixth man of the year in the Horizon League as he will get a rest. Averaging 6 points off the bench. He shoots 62% from three-point range.
All right, here's an idea. Fernandez is in the game. You target whoever he is covering. Give them the ball in a clear-out situation and see if you can get him to get that fifth foul.
He is guarding Tybee. Tybee took the three, can't hit. And the ball will go back to Valparaiso, up four. 7:53 remaining. On Big Monday. So we heard Chris and LaFonso talk about Dratty Gymnasium at Manhattan College. Tim, the last time you and I were there, we saw college basketball history. Lucky us, we called the lowest scoring game in shot clock history.
Do you remember the score? I mean, it was in the 30s.
Something like 35-32.
It was great defense, right?
Tybee with the wild shot. My favorite moment of that game, late in the game, I asked you, so Tim, is this bad, good defense or bad offense? And you said, unquestionably horrific offense, the most horrific offense I've ever seen. And another turnover. So we'll go back over to the Panthers. Jordan Johnson back in.
You know, Rob Jeter's defensive philosophy is to build a fort around the lane. But with Alec Peters, you have to know who you're covering. Two huge defensive mistakes here in the second half. He shoots 45% from the field from three. 48% on the year. Four out of eight in this game. You can't do that.
The three is no good by Whitman. We saw him hit two early in the half. He hit the two from the other side of the court. Tybee. Inside the seven-minute mark, it's Valparaiso by four, looking for win number 25. They've already clinched their fourth Horizon League regular season title in 5 years. Johnson back on the floor after sitting with four fouls. Could not finish. Darian Walker gives to Nickerson.
Now, Valpo 7-1 on the road in the Horizon. You can see the amount of poise that they're showing, just waiting for the shot that they love.
Shot clock inside 10. The step back jumper is no good by Carter. Last touch by Valparaiso, still 26 to shoot.
Now, I've watched a lot of Milwaukee basketball this year, and I'm not familiar with this Matt Tybee. He is so high energy and enthusiastic, and he just is not playing with energy. And I just don't think they can win this game if he doesn't have a strong finish.
Arians with the miss. Rebound Adekoya. Tybee is 2-for-8 from the floor tonight. Darian Walker drives. Good hands by Johnson. Remember, he's got four fouls. Baseline inbound for the Crusaders.
A big key for Milwaukee in this game. An 18-6 advantage scoring off of the Valpo turnovers.
Peters off the screen. Finally with a miss. But Walker hustles for the rebound but unable to save. Here's Johnson. Remember, he's got four fouls. Didn't stop him from taking it right to the rim. Tybee's shot will not drop. Whitman, kick out, Arian, three. And the rebound looked like it went off Peter's hands. It did.
Safe to say that Austin Arians is one of the best shooters in the entire conference. And guess what, Bob? He's just not shooting well. He has had an off-shooting season.
0-for-5 tonight, all from three-point range.
Now
Approaching the five-minute mark. Milwaukee will finish either as the fourth, fifth, or sixth seed in the Horizon League. The kick out to Springs for the three, and another offensive rebound by Arians. Here's Wickman, another three. And on the rebound, we'll get a rebound foul on Valparaiso. We'll be on Carter, his third.
Yeah, a couple minutes ago, you know, we promoed the Syracuse game against North Carolina. And as I think about that, they rely so heavily on Michael Benajay and Trevor Cooney and Malachi Richardson. Once you get close to March, you can't be a three-point shooting team and expect to continue making with tired legs.
Now, Valpo would have had the ball anyway. And Adekoya goes to the free throw line. Tybee, the 6'8 senior from Urbandale, Iowa. Preseason first team, all Horizon League choice. So Adekoya nails the two free throws, and now Valpo will retain possession.
And Tybee's got a great bloodline. Both his parents played ball. His dad's a Hall of Fame coach in the state of Iowa where he grew up.
Adekoya sets the screen. Carter. Adekoya baseline. Kick out Hamming. One more rotation to Peters, but it would not drop. So it could have been worse for Milwaukee. It winds up a two-point possession. Johnson feeds Tybee inside, and the foul will be on Adekoya. Three on Adekoya, and five team fouls on the Crusaders.
The biggest principle of the Bo Ryan swing offense is the ability to go into the post, and Rob Jeter expects 15 to 20 post touches per half. And with Fernandez out of the game, here he comes back in at a good time. Rob Jeter's going to have to change his philosophy a little bit with the league's top shot blocker, or at least the school's top shot blocker, patrolling the lane.
Tybee now with 9 points, and it's a four-point lead. Last time out, Fernandez blocked five shots last Sunday on Senior Day against Detroit. Carter with a deep three, air ball. Last touch by Valpo. A little quick on the trigger there.
I didn't like that shot one bit, but Valparaiso has shot well from three in this game. 9 out of 24 is not bad when you consider that their counterparts from Milwaukee are 4 for 22.
For the year, Valpo shoots 36% for three. Johnson on the drive, and he'll draw the blocking foul. Boy, he's not changing his style of play. The style is to attack despite having four fouls. So instead, the foul will go on Carter.
Jordan Johnson is fearless to the rim. And one of the keys to the success that he had personally against Kay Felder from Oakland. Kay Felder, one of the best stories in all of college basketball. Undersized. Right at the top of the scoring, and is still very hopeful that if things don't work out, that they would have a good enough resume for an at-large bid. I'm not so confident, and Joe Lenardi shared the same thing with you earlier today. Look, I think it's going to be an exciting tournament. Oakland has elite scoring. Wright State is 2-0 so far against Valparaiso, and I think the Green Bay and Detroit and Milwaukee all would like their chances as well.
On the drive, Savon Walker with the miss, but Walker was out of bounds when he came back in, so the ball will go back to Milwaukee. Now we get our four-minute media timeout with the lead at two. Million brackets were entered.
Yeah, in this season of upsets, Milwaukee is in a great position, and amazingly, they've missed their last nine shots. Their last field goal, 8-32, and they're only down by 2 points.
Arians with the miss, Fernandez rebound. We have now gone 4 minutes and 45 seconds since either team has had a field goal. Carter. See if they try to get into Peter's hands. Goes around the Fernandez screen. Kicks out to Carter. He has it knocked away. Tavon Walker for three. Dagger.
In this game, we should celebrate a three-pointer going in. Valpo only 38% from the field. Milwaukee less than that at 32.
First points of the night for Tavon Walker. It opens up a five-point Valpo lead. Tybee for three to match. More wins to break the record held by Guy Penwell.
Rob actually has the Division I all-time lead.
Tavon Walker down low to Fernandez, but Tavon Walker called for the charge after releasing the pass. Fernandez looked like he was all set for a flush.
You know, love the footwork by Arians, and good example of a guy that has had an off game. Arians 0-for-6 from the field, but has not stopped working. Three offensive rebounds and a huge charge.
17th turnover for Valparaiso. They're fourth in the Horizon League in turnover margin. 2 minutes remaining, two-point game. Johnson with the tough shot to tie. He's got 11. We've got a heck of a finisher, partner.
I'm just a little bit curious after the comments from Sean Miller at Arizona, knocking off the powerhouse in your conference, do you think that there's a court storming coming here?
We'll get a timeout here for Valparaiso as we take a look at the game-tying basket by Jordan Drew, NBA wins. What do you suppose Bryce Drew drew up during this crucial timeout?
Well, he's got Walker, Darian Walker, and he's also got Alec Peters as two hot, confident weapons, but I like Hammock off the dribble.
And here's Hammock off the dribble. He's got 10, and the lead is 2 for Valparaiso. Milwaukee still with 2 timeouts. Whitman drives. Back out to Springs. Looks like they're isolating Springs on the side. He takes it right at Carter and ties it.
Well, Springs is a man. Big physical guard, 6'4", a perfect swing offense player.
You liked Hammock off the dribble last time. You want to do it again?
I love it, and especially because he's surrounded by shooters. Bryce Drew relies heavily on motion offense. But
14 seconds left in the shot clock. Tie game. Carter around the Peters screen. Gets a step. Gives to Peters for the drive and the lead. Milwaukee has 2 timeouts left. They're not going to use it. Tybee puts it on the deck. He drives. And they will call a blocking foul. So Tybee will get a chance to tie it from the free throw line.
I love the fact that in the pregame, we focused on Peters and we focused on the big man. Tybee and Peters both stepped out of their comfort zone. They're mainly jump shooters, and they put the ball on the floor and tried to finish.
Tybee, the fourth best free throw shooter in the league at 83%. He's 5-for-7 tonight. Valparaiso with no timeouts left. And we're tied.
So at this juncture of the game, I love the ball in Keith Carter's hands. He is a prime ball handler and penetrator. And what Bryce Drew has done is use Peters in a high pick and roll situation. They're going to want to take this down as far as they can, about 3 seconds difference.
Between the shot clock and the game clock. Adekoya to Carter.
Now watch for Peters.
He's on the low block. Shot clock inside 10. Here comes Peters up high to set the screen.
Mismatch.
Peters with a smaller man on him. Loses the handle. Here comes Milwaukee in transition with one for the win. No good by Springs. And we're headed into overtime. You didn't think Peters NCAA tournament should they not win the Horizon League tournament. Keep in mind as we enter overtime, Jordan Johnson from Milwaukee and Keith Carter and Vasheel Fernandez for Valparaiso all have four fouls. Valpo has won eight of its last nine. Arians with the first shot of overtime.
And that's his first bucket of the game. He was 0 for 6 at that point.
0 for 5 from three-point range. Hammond penetrates. Kicks out to Carter for three. 9 points for Carter. So both point guards who are defending one another, Johnson and Carter, each with four fouls. Johnson with the defensive play of the night as he stripped Peters, who was going up for the game-winning shot with 4 seconds left. And now Tybee will be called for the discard, and that's his fourth foul.
He's very physical. Had the flagrant one about 4 minutes ago and completely laid out Keith Carter. Keith Carter baited him a little bit. He said, oh, I'm in big trouble here. I've got to cover a truck. And I'd love to see Keith Carter get really aggressive. He knocked down the three, be a playmaker.
Peters with the shot fake and drive to the goal. Very nicely done. He's got 20. Seventh time he's scored 20 points this year. Valpo by three, 3.5 left in overtime. Johnson with the drive. And on the rebound, Tybee outworked everybody, and it was last touch by Valpo.
You know, for anybody that's kind of surprised that Milwaukee is such a good team, don't be. They've actually won in two Big Ten arenas this year. They beat Wisconsin at the Kohl Center in the non-conference. They beat Minnesota at Williams Arena and only lost at Notre Dame by 8. So this Milwaukee team is very talented and capable.
Tybee with the foot on the line. No, it is a three. 17 points for Tybee. And just like that, we're tied. 2 minutes gone in overtime. Tybee tried to draw a foul off the ball on Fernandez. It would have been his fifth. He didn't get it. Hammond, great body control to pull up and avoid the charge. Low block. Peters shuffles it to Fernandez.
Peters has taken over.
First points of the game for 6'10", Vasheel Fernandez.
And let's watch him on the defensive end. When big guys get the ball, they become better defenders.
Down low, Springs over Peters. Rebound Fernandez with 2:30 remaining. His seventh rebound of the night.
Yeah, this is where they set up a play and try to get the ball in Peters' hands.
Air ball, but a great hustle to save it. Hammock still tries to save it. And then finally,
what an incredible sequence.
Called a foul on Milwaukee, Tim. And the only way that foul was made possible is because of a series of hustle plays by Valpo to try to keep the possession alive.
And it started with Alec Peters. Watch this save.
There's one.
It goes into the backcourt.
There's three.
You know, Hammock made the best play of all because he was going to throw the ball back to the middle of the court. It would have been a turnover and layup. That was brilliant.
That is only the fifth team foul on Milwaukee. Remember, the team fouls carry over from the second half into overtime. So they have yet to put Valpo on the bonus. Peters, how about his overtime? A three, and a dish for a dunk. Panoski for three. You wondered, where is he? Well, there he is. Timeout Milwaukee. Two-point game with 1:44 remaining.
Remember, we went.
Here we go. Valparaiso ball up to 1:40 remaining in overtime. Peters all alone in the far corner. And Tavon Walker nearly got it to go, and he'll get a trip to the line. Well, you said take it to the rim. Walker certainly did there.
And did you see how far out on the perimeter that defensively Milwaukee was pulled out? Walker has had a slow game, only 1 for 6, and Jordan Johnson, the Milwaukee catalyst, is going to have to sit down. He's fouled out with 11 points.
And remember, he's helpful at both ends of the floor. Second to the country in assists. And the reason this game perhaps is in overtime is because of the brilliant defensive play he made on an Alec Peters shot with a couple of seconds left in regulation. First trip to the line tonight for Tavon Walker.
Yeah. Another free throw makes it a two-possession game. And with Jordan Johnson on the bench, the primary playmaker would be big power guard Akeem Springs. I'd love to see them iso him and let him try to get to the rim.
And Tim, interestingly enough, despite the fact that Valpo is headed back on defense, during that stoppage, Bryce Drew took his shot blocker, Fernandez, out of the game. Here's Arians, a contested three. And the lead is down to one. He has saved his best for overtime.
That long possession here.
Carter to Tavon Walker. Hammett fake the three, drives. And they call the basket and the foul, or is it a charge?
Looks like a charge.
It's a charge.
Yeah, Austin Arians has taken two huge charges in the last 4 minutes of this game. Feet set, contact, and we knew he was going to drive. Let's see if he gets his feet outside. Yep, absolutely. And he's got four fouls, Bob.
So now it goes the other way. Possession to Milwaukee. Down by one. 1:01 remaining. With Jordan out, Brock Stull handling the ball at the point. Tybee screaming for the ball on the low block. They isolate him on that side. He goes right and out of court for the lead.
It would have been nice to have Fernandez in the game defensively in that situation.
Valparaiso uses its final timeout tonight. All right, what do you suppose Bryce Drew called in that huddle?
When they need a bucket, they put the ball in Carter's hands and they go pick and roll situation.
Instead, Carter with a quick three. How about that? 2-point lead. Milwaukee has two timeouts left. Looks like Rob Jeter's going to use one right here. 31. Sure did. Milwaukee ball stole. And the big fellow Fernandez is not on the floor. Tybee being guarded by Adekoya again. Shot clock down to 13. Tybee behind the arc just threw it up. Left his feet without knowing what he wanted to do. And we get a foul on Milwaukee. What was that?
Now, I think he tried to draw the foul. Excellent up and down defense. And he just threw it up. And if you look, he had a cutter to the basket that was wide open. Watch right here. Wide open under the basket. It was Arians that would have had an uncontested layup.
So Carter at the line for the 1-1. If he makes them both, we make it a two-possession game. First trip to the line tonight.
Yeah, I also want to give Bryce Drew a lot of credit. You'd think, why would you have your best shot blocker out of the game? He wanted to make sure that he had a perimeter-oriented defense to cover the three-point line.
Carter, a 59% free throw shooter, nails them both to make it a four-point lead with 13 seconds left. Rob Jeter will use his last. But it doesn't help if you can't put the team at the line with the foul.
And Valparaiso can basically run things out.
Here's Wickman for three, no good. Rebound Tybee, makes the two to cut it to two with 3 seconds left. They committed the quick.
One more free throw, ball game.
If not, Milwaukee has 3.3 to go to the length of the floor to get a three, but it's all academic now. So Valparaiso comes into Milwaukee and will come away by beating the Panthers for the fourth straight time and for the ninth time in the last 10 years. And it's win number 25 for the Crusaders. Final score, Valparaiso 80 and Milwaukee 76.